take this forward. Boy, Bharat beyond the 3rd of May, life versus livelihood, where earlier overwhelmingly life won, is livelihood slowly catching up and is this balance now slowly tilting? It's the question that we are asking. Let's go to our guests who've been patiently waiting. Rajiv Pratap Rudi, BJP MP with us and national spokesperson of the BJP also with us. Vijay Shankar Pandey, who's the former GOI secretary with us. Dr. Niranjan Hiranandani, president NARADCO and ASSOCHAM is also with us. And we also have Shankar Iyer, economist with us. Shankar Iyer, good to have you join us from Toronto. Hope everything is all right at your end. I'm going to start with you and then go across to Dr. Hiranandani and Vijay Shankar Pandey and Rajiv Rudi. Shankar Iyer, let me ask you this. How is Canada dealing with it? How is neighboring America dealing with it? And compared to that, is India doing better? And this challenge between life and livelihood, is there any way to balance this?
Well, as soon as we know the pandemic was declared, it was always known that there was going to be a tension between life and livelihood. The difference between what's happening in north of America, across the Atlantic, and what's happening in India is that India is still yet to sort of is behind on the curve of the infection transmission and safety zone. So while we are doing well, I wouldn't declare victory because that might send the wrong signals to people. And already the fear always is that people might give up on the social distancing that has helped India till now. The point that on the economic front, the difference is that Canada, America have all announced their packages, their stimulus packages, even before the lockdown is lifted. To me, it is a bit mystifying why the Indian stimulus package has not yet come out of the Ministry of Finance. One wonders whether there are logical reasons or astrological reasons for this. Even the liquidity facility that has been opened up for the mutual fund, I wonder what was the need for a cap of 50,000 on it. All that the RBI is doing is buying investment grade paper from mutual funds and keeping a liquidity tap on. Total collections in mutual funds is 24 lakh crores. 50,000 crores is not a big amount, it's not a small amount, but I understand maybe there is a need to message that you made 50,000 crore available. The point that is critical to India's life and livelihood story is how do you deal with those people who have had no livelihood for the last 1 month and more? And how will you deal with them when you still open up the economy? The economy is not going to open up in one flat stretch. So there are these questions that are hovering here. Canada and US have announced and transferred payments to people. Canada is paid $2,000 per month to people who have lost their jobs or who haven't been able to go to work or find a job. In the US, 175 million people are getting money. It is true that in India also we've had a transfer. The transfer to women is a splendid idea. The insurance for health workers is a splendid idea. But I cannot understand why the RBI or the Ministry of Finance is dragging its feet on the need for operating capital credit for small and medium enterprises, which employ the largest number of people in the economy and are really hurting.
True. Shankar, I was speaking to somebody in the US who's heading a big company, and this is what they're saying. And let me take this across to Rajiv Pratap Rudi first and then bring it down, since you said that whether what the government is doing, and there was a question in terms of is there thought there at all. This is what is happening in the US right now. In the US, there is a huge group which is below 40 who are saying we are willing to risk it, Rajiv Pratap Rudi. It's a 95 million strong workforce. They are saying our fatality is lower. We will risk infection, but we have to go back to work. Why? Because they are saying there's a huge number which is having to sign up for unemployment. The government there, if you register yourself as unemployed, the government gives you a subsidy for 4 months and unemployment benefits, but all your health benefits are reduced. That's what happens if you file for unemployment. Now, in one company itself, I'm saying there are 92% of the company staff which is going to be sent on furlough and only about 80% is going to be retained. Now, this is a reality which is there in America, and we know it is a reality which is staring us here in India too.
Well,
we also have a very young workforce.
I really don't feel the need to compare what we are doing here with what US is doing. And that is a very developed nation. They have huge coffers and so forth and so on. My concern today is, the country with the population, we, as you are aware, under the lockdown, 1.7 billion people across the world were under the lockdown, out of which 1.3 billion people are in India. It's just 0.4 billion people. It was not Australia, it was not Germany, it was not US, partially yes and partially no, it was not Germany. India, which had a $3 trillion economy, came to an abrupt halt. 40 days of no work, entire chain disrupted. The choice was with the state governments and the central government, keep activity on, be ready to lose lives, or stop it, control it, come out gradually. And I think this is a major challenge. One, to fight and get out of the COVID, be successful, and B, to nudge back the economy. Now, this, I am not an economist, but I know the challenges which we are facing across. And at this point of time, it would be unfair to compare the situation in India and the Indian economy as compared to the United States of America, because that does not make much sense at this point of time. If you look at the travel and hospitality industry, which has 1.65 lakh crores of business, has more than 4 crore employees, 30 to 40 million employees we have lost job, the revenue loss is 50,000 crores. Aviation industry, tourism, retail, restaurant, real estate, and so forth and so on. It's not that it's Rajiv Pratap Rudy who knows about this. There are many people in the government, outside the government, fully aware of it. Now, given a choice, what is your choice? A, there is a pressure on from the society that, and everyone politically is agreeing that we have to protect lives first. That would disrupt the chain of the economy, which has already been disrupted. The second is, there are people who are saying, accusing us that not much an economy. It's a cash 22 situation, and any government of the day, you have to decide your priority. We know that we cannot outright the states which did not report of coronavirus. Bihar was so secure. Now Bihar has started reporting a rapid state of corona, which is coming in because migrant labor is coming back, so forth and so on. Think of a situation when there's 40 lakhs or 30 lakhs migrant laborers from Bihar and UP have come back. How do you restore that chain of work, of the work or the workmen in these factories, which are MSMEs? 65 to 70% of the economy is dependent, the GDP is on services and the manufacturing. Only 17%, 16 to 70% is agriculture.
Correct.
So just try to understand what are the challenges being faced by the government today. And me as a simple political representative, I am clueless. I cannot comment on it. And if anyone can tell us the final date of COVID ending, then we can plan it out. No one is on the channel.
Frankly, Rudy ji,
the final date.
Rudy ji, with all respect, sir, we are all here. See, we are all in this boat together. Let us accept this. We are all in this boat together. There are some people who have got the responsibility to point out the concern areas. There are others who have the responsibility to act on these concern areas. That is how it is. My point is, and I agree with you, till the time we have a cure for COVID-19, there is no expiry date for COVID. Even after we find a cure, there is no expiry date for COVID-19, unless we as a country, we have at least 70 crore of this population being infected and we get herd immunity where 50 plus or 60% of the population is infected. Dr. Hiranandani, I'm just coming to you, and then Vijay Shankar Pandey, and then we'll circle back to all our panelists once again. Dr. Hiranandani, I've just got some of the numbers which our research team has pulled out. Travel and tourism, 9 million jobs in the sector are at risk. Sector accounts to 12.75% of employment and 5.6% of direct and indirect. Okay, 87 million people employed in the tourism industry in 2018-2019. Hospitality and restaurants, again, job loss for about 38 million people. 7.2 of them are directly employed even under the NRAI. I know these numbers because the NRAI was there, representation was there the other day. Civil aviation, 3 million jobs. Again, $3.6 billion loss for civil aviation industry. Trade and exports, MSMEs, well, hospitals, medical care. There are only a few sectors which are doing well. The rest are all suffering. In this case, and I'm asking you this, is there an argument which will slowly build 40 days, 50 days into the lockdown, which will say that the larger number of the least fatality is among the larger workforce? That means fatality of 40 below is the least, and we have at least 70% of our workforce in that age. Now, can we look at striking a balance?
I am fully with you on that. The first and foremost issue that we have to talk about is the fact that what should be the stimulus package? Do we emulate America? Can we emulate America? Can we emulate US, Japan, or any of the foreign countries? My answer is no. We cannot compare ourselves with that country. So what do we say? Whom do we talk to? The person who has given us a very good figure and indication is Niti Aayog. I was on a panel with Niti Aayog just the other day, and they have made it very clear that we need 10 lakh crores to be the stimulus package. Now, whether it's compared with the United States, or it is to do with developing India, or it is a percentage of the GDP, I'm not the topmost expert in the country. However, in ASSOCHAM, as our indications were that this should be about 14 lakh crores, and FICCI has given 16 lakh crores. Now, I'm going on the conservative side that at least a 10 lakh crore fiscal stimulus package is needed. I could be wrong, I could be right, but up till now, what has been done is only 0.7 lakh crores. Now, I do believe that irrespective of what we may say, the stimulus package needed, what Mr. Iyer has said correctly, is that it is quite an under-giving which has happened today, though it has been given to the right segment. I fully agree that the lowest segment of society should be given first. The second suggestion that I have got, a very strong suggestion, is what you have said just now. We need to bifurcate the population, working population, amongst the young people and the old people. And I think the young people, definitely, I run a hospital and we have seen the results over there. There have been fatalities amongst the young people only with core morbidity and not otherwise. So I think we need to segregate the second part of it and be able to start it. The third part of it is the way the Reserve Bank has given credit availability into the market is not correct. We have got 7 lakh crores of rupees in reverse return by the banks. Instead of giving it into the market, it's gone into reverse back to the Reserve Bank of India. Now, 7 lakh crores, if it was given into the marketplace, instead of going back in reverse repo lending over there, I think we need to do something. I don't say how it should be done and whom should be given, but it needs to go into the marketplace, whether in tourism, whether in travel, whether in real estate, whether in manufacturing, whether in exports, but it needs to really go there. And the last part, which is the most important point according to me, and may I take a few minutes, a minute more on that. The government owes people in refund of IT, refund of VAT and GST, payments which they have to do in terms of NHAI, payments for fertilizer subsidies, payments to state governments. These amount to 2,20,000 crores. They are not even a part of the stimulus package. It's a part of the commitment of the central government or the PSUs of the central government to make payment. If we had even this 2,20,000 crores of rupees of stimulus, I call it stimulus, though it's actually overdue payments by the government to can be done. And this needs to be coming up immediately. Even if this is started, I think it will make a world of difference. So the figure, 10 lakh crores, as per Niti Aayog, as per ASSOCHAM and NAREDCO, we are saying 14 lakh crores, but 0.7 lakh crores is certainly not enough. So that's one part of it. And the second, workers must start working, whether, and especially young people, old workers and those with core morbidity and other parts should not be permitted to work, because then they be kept. And the numbers. The congratulations to the Prime Minister and the government for maintaining health of the people. I think wonderful job, but now livelihood is as important as taking care of life. I think about time we started.
Sir, very well point, very well set out there, sir, and some great points elucidated. And even if you were to take the Niti Aayog's number of 10 lakh crore, you are saying 2,20,000 crore is already supposed to be overdue, and so not even stimulus. You just have to pay these monies. These are overdue. You pay this money, and out of the reverse repo, the banks which are giving it back to the RBI, 7 lakh crore, even about 2 or 3 lakh crore, you are halfway through the 10 lakh crore figure put out by the Niti Aayog itself. I'm just saying, is the government holding its purses and not loosening its purses because it wants to wait? Because it feels this is not the right time to put money into the market. This is, we have to wait for some more time. I don't know. I'm no expert in this. I'm just putting it out there as a thought. As I go to Vijay Shankar Pandey ji, thank you for your patience. And then Mr. Rudy and Shankar Iyer, coming back to you. Just putting out some numbers. Compared to the 30th of March, again, the research team has just sent this out. 30th March 2020, 25th April 2020. The percentages of truck moving food and pharma was 46% on the 30th of March. On the 25th of April, it's 76%. Percentage of rakes moved was 67%. It's up to 76%. Traffic handled by ports, 70%. Now it is up to 87%. Traffic handled by ports. Operational major mandis, 61% on the 30th of March. And on the 25th of April, it is up to 79%. So clearly, some things have already started moving. Some things have already started happening. Now look at it. 109 time-tabled parcel trains, over 58 routes started by Indian Railways. 400 rakes moving day and night carrying food grains and other essential items. Greater than 2.5 lakh meals served every day by IRCTC across the four railway zones. 392 lifeline Udaan flights carrying 700 plus metric tons of essential cargo operated till date. 100 plus metric tons of medicine and medical equipment and 1 lakh food packets delivered every day by India Post. And payments and DBT worth 730 crore made to 34 lakh pensions per people by India Post. Now, these are numbers. So clearly something is happening behind the scenes that we are not seeing people out on the streets, and we are still seeing some amount of exchange, and still shops and essential supplies are still available across the country. But Vijay Shankar Pandey ji, coming back to this argument, going forward, do you believe this is the best way to go? That the workforce which is able, the workforce which has a natural ability to resist COVID-19 should be allowed to work. We take care of those with comorbidities and those who are more vulnerable and shield them.
Also,
sorry.
And as you know, that rural areas are absolutely open. So all the agriculture operations are there, marketing is there, all the shops have been opened. So a lot of things are happening. Now, the question is how to go about the opening up of the economy per se. Now, you know, if you look at it, there are two parts of it. One is the virus part. You know, the impact of coronavirus, I have no hesitation in saying that, and experts may differ, that it doesn't have that kind of impact on our population for reasons best known to experts. I'm not aware of that. But it's not impacting the country as it is impacting the other Western countries. So one fact is very clear. Second, I've been finding out from people across the various states about the condition of our patients in the hospitals. You know, you'll be very happy to know that the patients who are admitted to hospitals, very few of them are in critical condition and are requiring the use of ventilators. So it means that the virus is, even if it is affecting people and people are getting hospitalized, they are not in serious condition. And as some experts are already saying, that some medication, I'll not name those medicines because they are already in the public domain, they are having effect. And then the fourth thing is that the plasma therapy, it is also working somewhere. So overall, if you look at the picture, we are slightly comfortable as compared to other countries. And we, as far as the treatment goes, we are not in a position that our health system has been overwhelmed. Now let's come to the economic part. You know, 56% of our people are already self-employed. So, the moment you open, they are not bothered about what has happened to the economy earlier than. They will start their operation, and people are very, very eager. They are waiting. They are desperate now to go out and work. So time has come. Allow them to work. As you've already mentioned, a lot of things are happening. You know, the truck operation, why it has not picked up? You know, what I've learned, that, the drivers are so scared because of the fear factor. So even when they are being asked that there is no hesitation, no restriction, they're not coming out. So I will request one thing. The fear factor has to be undone somehow or the other. We have, you know, for, you know, the benefit of the people, we created that fear factor. It was right to some extent, to large extent, but time has come. You know, let's remember one thing. We have dealt with very contagious diseases in our country in the past also, and we have overcome them. You know, I was talking I'll quote this, I'm talking to a doctor who has handled TB patients throughout his life. It's a very contagious disease. But he mentioned to me very clearly, he has never used, you know, mask ever treating any of his patients. You know, it's the mindset. Mindset is that, correct, don't be scared. It may catch you, but it's not fatal. As I mentioned to you, the condition in our country is good as far as coronavirus is concerned. Some kind of medicines, correct, other things are working. Our population, which is below 50, I'll say, is not getting affected much. People who have died to a large extent are those who suffered from other ailments. It added, it became an add-on on their, you know, right, health, you know, the condition. So in a nutshell, the time has come. Right. We should start opening the economy because people are getting restless. Now time has come, allow them to work. And as far as the economy is concerned, you know, we are not a totally a capitalist economy that, you know, we are
I understand, sir, but I'm going to take your own example here that we cannot then make them absolutely fearless because there has to be a certain level of fear. In fact, a lot of doctors, and I'm going to go back to Shankar Iyer, a lot of doctors said that, you know, COVID-19 is going to teach us a few hygiene factors and a few habits which will help us overcome far more life-threatening and communicable diseases. One, the biggest one of them is the biggest challenge is TB. Perhaps the COVID-19 habits will help us control the spread of TB and actively identify more TB patients compared to COVID-19 patients is what a doctor also said. And he says, no, I'm saying it with all the more seriousness because TB is the most lethal disease. COVID-19 mortality rate is less than 3%. TB claims 3,330 people every day. Yes, Shankar Iyer. And then final comment with Rajiv Pratapudi. Yeah.
I think, Anand, we must be very careful when we say that fear should be dismantled because it is fear which has kept the transmission and helped the government, and the Prime Minister's message has been about that need to flatten the curve. So we have to be very careful when we say how we proceed from here. Singapore has had a second wave. They're talking about the third wave. Sweden has had a second wave. So we don't know enough about the virus to say how it will process or how it will affect people. Yes, there is a need to open up the economy, and that has to be planned. Now, how do you contain, how do you keep workers safe and workplace safe? These are issues. You might be able to use the Aadhaar platform to store data on who's been tested or not tested. The Aadhaar QR code could be used for clearing people. So we already have a digital infrastructure. We have NPCI for direct benefit transfer payments. Yes, we are not as big an economy. We are not a G7 economy like Canada or America. But you can't be waiting for the eventuality to act. It is a fact that for 40 days, people have not had jobs. Maybe 30 to 32% of the economy is working. It is a fact that all those people who are daily wagers, who are self-employed, have had no income.
Right.
So these people form the supply chain, as do MSMEs. Right. So we have to plan this. So the balance between life and livelihood, we have to come up with a technocratic solution which is acceptable politically. Which is where the whole architecture of government comes into play. It's not, we cannot now wait for an expiry date on COVID because there is no expiry date for COVID. We know we have finite resources and infinite needs. Finally, I would say this, that we must remember that just like the virus makes people with comorbidity more vulnerable, India's economy has simply moved from slowdown to lockdown. So we have comorbidity and we have to think about that. These 2 lakh crores that Hiranandani spoke about, the overdue Correct. Income tax refunds. All these are issues that need to be addressed. And this is an opportunity for India to recast Right. its government.
Right. Let's hope it does. Let's hope it happens. I'm sorry, I have paucity of time. So, Mr. Rudy, we will take this conversation forward because we are going to discuss this at length on a day-to-day basis. Dr. Hiranandani, always wonderful having you, and you just brilliantly encapsulated the entire piece. We should actually put that out as a suggestion and think this is how we can approach. Shankar Iyer, good to have you with us, and we need to take this forward, this conversation forward. So I look forward to you also joining us on the right stand. And Vijay Shankar Pandeyji, thank you very much. Yes, I agree with the overall sentiment that there has to be a balance that needs to be struck, and it's a tightrope walk. It's a very, very tough walk for the Prime Minister and the entire team, which has got the responsibility on our behalf to do it. Everybody is thinking on the same lines. Let's hope we can crack this together. We need to do it. Thank you very much. We're going to take a very, very short break. When we come back, it's the voice which binds you. Moh Moh Ke Dhaage Se Lekar, so many more hits. But we are also going to get a little bit of the traditional local flavor. This is a shout out to the Northeast. A talent they cherish, a talent India cherishes. With me on the other side. After this short break, on the right note, pop on.